A very warm welcome to everyone, and thank you for taking the time to join us today. We are very pleased to have organized this panel discussion on the topic of active mobility in healthy cities, a topic which I'm sure is very important to many of you here today, and boy, is the hall full. I see some standing room only at the back. First, a little introduction. The Center for Livable Cities and the US-based Urban Land Institute have jointly studied this subject in the research project Creating Healthy Places Through Active Mobility, which was also partly funded by the Urban Innovation Grant from the ULI. In this project, the team studied many challenges and different approaches that other cities have adopted to promote active mobility. Jan Gehl, the renowned Danish urbanist, also contributed a lot by sharing his insights and vast experience from case studies across the world. Today, a panel discussion is one of the outcomes of the collaborative research project with multiple agencies as well as with the Urban Land Institute on the topic. The continuing collaboration with the Urban Land Institute has been greatly rewarding and builds on our previous collaborative project on the 10 principles for livable high density cities, which was completed in early 2013, and the last I heard is going to be translated into Mongolian for Ulaanbaatar. So, and at the World City Summit 2014, earlier this year, the Mayor of Bandung, His Excellency Ridwan Kamil, and Lord Mayor of Melbourne, Robert Doyle, as well as experts in this field, including Professor Jan Gehl and Professor Marilyn Taylor, who is the Dean of the University of Pennsylvania School of Design, they all contributed their ideas on active mobility. And we published the findings in the book, which I'm sure all of you are holding on to now, which was launched in both Singapore and New York on October 22nd at the ULI Fall Meeting. Our conclusion is that when more people walk and cycle, there will be substantial benefits to the individual, society, environment, and the economy. The book also provides suggestions as to how to make Singapore more walkable and cyclable, with lessons drawn from cities such as Amsterdam, Taipei, Copenhagen, Seoul, and New York City. Singapore's planning has always embraced active mobility, but we are not perfect. As we have seen in the book, some cities like Amsterdam and Copenhagen have raised active mobility to a higher level. Walking and cycling as a mode of transport has been the normal way of life. In these cities, they make up more than half of the mode of transport. Benchmark against them, many cities would find themselves behind. For instance, cycling in Singapore merely makes up about 1-2% of our transport mode here. And as such, today's discussion will focus about the learning from cities and sharing of experiences. We have a panel comprising of very experienced planners, designers, and implementers for active mobility who will be sharing their experiences as well as how we would be implementing active mobility for Singapore. But before we begin, we'll be sharing a quick 2-minute look at the book as a small slideshow to introduce the topic.
Thank you.
Okay, let's start the discussion today. We all know that cycling culture is very well established in Copenhagen. And in fact, this Copenhagenized index, which is a measure of cycling in cities, is named after Copenhagen. So Camilla, can you tell us how Copenhagen managed to build up such a successful cycling culture?
I'm not going to do my talk yet. Okay.
No, you do your talk, but from the seat. Yes.
Well, first of all, can I say to the nice people standing up here, all of us are stuck in these chairs, so please come and have a comfortable seat in the front. Come on. You're kind of stuck there and there's empty chairs in the front. Copenhagen, I think, has been very successful in that regardless of the political leadership for the last 40 to 50 years, the policy has always been the same. So there's been a consistency and a determination on putting cycling first in the city and prioritizing that. And that is regardless of the political leadership.
You will use the slides, right?
Yeah. Can I use the
slides? Yeah,
oh, can
course,
I? Oh,
yeah.
From can here. I sit? Yes. Okay. Yeah. I'm going to sit and talk. Okay. Yeah. Can I talk? Can I stand and
sure.
talk instead?
Okay. There's some seats right here as well.
Yeah,
there's four
lots,
seats in the front
lots
here.
Lots of seats. Okay. I think if, yeah. Yeah, I can. Okay. I just prefer that. It's kind of it's nice to stand. So in Copenhagen. First of all, I'd like to say thank you to the generosity of the CLC. I've been here three times the last 6 months, and I've really enjoyed seeing the development of this project. So thank you very much for hosting us. We do come from a city that's known for cycling. This is a picture from Copenhagen. It's our newest cycling facility, a new bridge. It's rather a small investment. It's 38 million kroner, which is about $6 million. But it's actually used by 14,000 cyclists every day that cross the water and tie two areas of the city together that formerly were not connected, creating new jobs, new patterns in the city. So I think this bridge is a really important symbol, at least in my city, of actually putting the values and the money where we speak. And that's something I'll be getting back to today, why that's important. Because creating a good city for cyclists and for active mobility is really about making the decisions and making the priorities. It's about discussing what kind of city we want. Do we want a city full of cars where we invite more and more cars to come in, or do we want a city that invites people? And at some point in our route or on our journey, we are all pedestrians, whether it is just the 5 meters from our front door to our car. But looking at the softest mode of transport, the pedestrian, and maybe even the bicyclist, is, in our opinion, the way to create a really good and people-friendly city that fosters active mobility. As I mentioned, Copenhagen was not always like this. Right after the Second World War, there were lots of bicyclists everywhere in Copenhagen, but during the 50s and 60s and 70s, many of our main streets, this is the street Strøget, which is today a very famous pedestrian street, Strøget was completely full of cars. So Copenhagen has not always been this fairy tale place of bicyclists. The thing that dramatically changed the path Copenhagen was on was in the early 70s, in 1973, when we had a large oil crisis. Suddenly people started to see the city in a new light. There were bicycle-free Sundays every Sunday. You could not drive your car unless you were a doctor or a policeman. And suddenly people saw that the city and the streets could be used for something else. And through a number of measures, slowly the laws about how you could take your car into the city center, where you could park, made cycling the better and the more obvious choice. And in 2002, we marked quite a remarkable shift where we had more cyclists coming into the city center than we had cars in the city. And at least for us, it is also a question of logic and of mathematics. Much like Singapore, we are a country where we have to be wary about our space, and a cycle track can simply carry much more amount of people. Up to 5 times as many people can be on a cycle track than on a car lane. So it's a very efficient way of, in a sustainable manner, transporting large amounts of people. I think one of the keys to the success in Copenhagen has always been that it has been, from the first start in the 70s, a very fine-grained network that is on the streets itself. The top map, which has some red lines, are the bicycle lanes on the streets in Copenhagen. And the bicycle lanes on the streets were always the first to be built. Not until the last 5 or 10 years have we begun to build bicycle lanes on the green lines, which is the bottom map, it's a little difficult to see, which are placed in our parks. So the bicycle lanes were always about transportation, about getting from door to door as part of your everyday movement, and not about recreation, not about exercise, but an equal form of urban transportation. And as you can see, now we have more than 350 kilometers of bicycle lanes, and that has taken us a good deal of 50 years. I think an important lesson, the book that we've seen the examples from also mentioned New York. New York has done the same amount of bicycle lanes in a mere 3 years. So you do not have the disadvantage if you start late. You can definitely still win the race. Another part of the success of Copenhagen is the priority that is given to people right into the design of the space. This is what we call a people-first design. You might notice that the white car that is coming from a side street here has to stop and pause because the pedestrian sidewalk and the bicycle lane is taken across the side street. So there's giving a very clear priority to the bicycles and to the pedestrians. And in all the little details, like the right of way to turn right at a green light first, or to have all the intersections timed so that a bicycle going at about 18 to 20 kilometers an hour has a green wave through the city. All of these engineering refinements of the traffic system puts the bicycles first. And of course, as our network grows, now we have almost 40% of our modal share through bicycles. Of course, there are challenges to our system. And now, today, we have to make low and fast speed bicycle tracks like you would have on a highway. But all of the little details, from the signs to a small gesture that says, "Hello, bicyclists, please relax and thank you for bicycling," a little footrest when you're waiting, or even a dustbin, a trash can, angled to fit the bicyclist as he or she rides by. All of these little details, of course, come with a network and the increased modal share that we do have. And this is something that you can absolutely, this is air to pump your bicycle, counter that counts how many bicycles that goes past every day. All of these amenities are absolutely something that we see cities as they are implementing these systems. The faster it goes, the more of these amenities come in sooner. So I think cities are learning from each other today, being inspired by some of these things and seeing what works. We are not we're not blessed with your fantastic climate in my city. And we actually do continue to bicycle in the winter. 70% of those of us who bicycle do it also in the winter. And why is that? Because the bicycle lanes are cleared first. And I think that's something very important, that in order to have a success in the system, you must not only have the hardware, the physical infrastructure on the streets, but you also have to work with the software, the culture, the maintenance, the cleaning crews within the municipality need to think about this as well. So all of these levels are part of the success of actually making it a reliable mode of transport where people feel they can move away. You can also take your bicycle on the train, on the water bus in the harbor, on the metro, and you can do so for free. So it's a really nice way to commute for longer distances because there's complete inter-travel mobility between the different types of transportation. Even on a taxi, by law, you are required to be able to take two bicycles on your taxi. So the final question is, why do we cycle in Copenhagen? Is it because we are very concerned with the environment? This is 1 ton of CO2, this balloon illustration. Every year in Copenhagen, we make counts, the city counts how many pedestrians and how many cyclists are on the street, and they ask people why they cycle. And it's not really because we care about the environment, only 1% of us do. Is it because we're really poor and we can't afford a nice car? Cars are almost as expensive as in Singapore, in Copenhagen. Not so much either. Is it because we're really afraid of getting fat? Yes, partially. But most of us, 61% of us in Copenhagen, cycle because it is simply the fastest, most convenient way of transporting ourselves in our city. And I think that is really the key to success and something that can be looked at. We must make cycling the first and the easiest choice. Thank you very much.
Thanks, Camilla. And so we have heard that Copenhagen has quite a history of transformation. Moving from a car-oriented mobility culture in the 70s to a very vibrant urban cycling culture today. So the question I would like to put to the panel first is, how do you think cities can start? Because starting to move away from the car-based transportation model towards promoting active mobility might be the hardest step. And Camilla, you said that New York managed to do it in 3 years. Being a Johnny-come-lately in the cycling culture, how did New York actually get started on this?
Okay, this time I'll do it sitting. Yeah. So New York started really with when Mayor Bloomberg appointed Jeanette Sadiq Khan as traffic commissioner in 2007. And very quickly he said that he wanted to have a city that was greener and greater. And in order to do that, he wanted to promote active mobility, cycling. And a series of pilot projects was really the first way of starting to transform New York. This was also about delivering results quickly. So at the time, Bloomberg was in question for running to later run for president, which we all know he didn't. But at that time, it was really about getting projects on the ground fast. And the pilot projects of New York City became a way of demonstrating that. I think there's some illustrations in the book also of some of the pilot projects. And it was this idea of testing and refining, seeing if it worked, seeing if the money that was being spent was putting the bicycle lanes in the right places before they made real capital investments, but also getting results out on the streets fast and getting a really big cohesive network in from the beginning. And I think that's key. Because if there's not a cohesive network, if you can't rely on it to get you from A to B, if it suddenly disappears, the bicycle lane suddenly disappears, evaporates into thin air as you're driving with your children on it, then you don't trust the system. So in the hen or the egg discussion, it's always imperative, and I think that's what New York did quite successfully, to get the infrastructure in first.
How about Cliff? What are we doing on, getting started in Singapore?
having just heard from what Camilla said, I think we pale in comparison. As we all know, we are quite road and public transport oriented, but the first and last mile is something that I think going forward, government agencies, we need to work together to see how we can enhance this. And this is where I think agencies recognize this, and we have come together to try to do something about it. So this is something I will just run through with you later on with the slides.
And perhaps, Kenneth, you can tell us if there are, you know, in besides infrastructure, what kinds of programs might be in place?
Yeah. I think infrastructure is just one piece of the puzzle. Singapore started quite late in this. We rolled out the National Cycling Plan. I'll talk a little about this later on, with the aim to create about 700 kilometers of tracks. But a few other pieces need to come together besides infrastructure. The other piece being education. We have, after all, a fairly diverse group of users on the road, even cyclists, from the young ones to the elderly, to people of different, some locals, some foreigners. And I think education is one key piece. Perhaps the other piece that's also needed, unfortunately, is also enforcement. A lot more, I think, perhaps also needs to be done. Traffic police does some of that today. Perhaps more could be done. These are probably the three key pieces: infrastructure, education, and enforcement that's needed.
Okay, well, maybe let's talk about climate, since Camilla, you know, showed us that the Danes would cycle even in deep winter. And I know Scott, you know, has studied in Canada and been working in this part of the world quite a bit. How do you think tropical cities, you know, could actually do this? Because a lot of successful examples of cycling seem to have taken place in temperate countries.
Thank you, Lubin. I guess before I start with that, just on behalf of ULI, I'd like to thank. I see a lot of familiar faces in the audience who participated in the workshops that we did and the publication of the book. So I really greatly appreciate all of the support and the help that the people in the audience who are part of this, in terms of having a published document that has generated a lot of response, both here locally as well as when we launched this in New York 2 weeks ago. It generated a lot of response at our ULI fall meeting, which has over 6,000 people from around the world gathered to talk about real estate development issues. And active mobility was one of the key issues that came up. I think in terms of just with the climate and that, I come from a place that is minus 30 for about 5 months out of the year. And minus 30 would be on a good day. I mean, a lot of times it goes a lot colder than that. And then it'll go up to plus 30. So living in a tropical climate where you can be outside, you can walk, you can cycle every day, I still don't understand why people don't do more of it. But for a lot of it, I think it comes down to what we had in our 10 principles here, in terms of 10 kind of guiding factors, was the number one was making it easy and convenient. If it's easy and convenient, I think this has been pointed out already, you'll take that as an option to use it. Even if the weather is poor, being really, really hot or really, really cold, if it's more convenient to walk somewhere or bike somewhere, you'll pick that as a mode transport instead of getting in a car, trying to heat up a car or get through traffic or battle everybody to get onto a train. So that's the kind of fundamental part. Then if you put that as a fundamental principle, and a lot of the work that we're doing in major metropolitan areas in terms of the design side is, how do you connect those facilities? How do you do the last kilometer? How do you connect from your home to the public transportation? Then how do you connect from where that drops you off to your end destinations, which may be civic, they may be office, they may be tourism destinations, but how do you make that as easy, as convenient as possible? And I think that's where I know that some people feel like we haven't started yet, but it's always a good time to start. And I think that's something that Singapore has started, and there's been a lot of work done on this over the last year.
Maybe Cliff, as a planner in Singapore, you can let us know if there are any things going for us that actually would help to encourage cycling even in the tropical weather.
I think weather is indeed a concern, because when we did our draft master plan 2013 last year, one of the surveys we did put out was on cycling. And yes, it did feature quite strongly that climate is one of the deterrents that people do not cycle today. But having said that, we recognize that more can be done. For instance, we are quite blessed because our NParks colleagues have lined all our roadside to have trees, right? So that provides some form of shade to it. On top of that, I think LTA is also working towards trying to provide covered linkways and so forth within 400 meters of transport nodes. So all these things will help enhance active mobility for that first and last mile. But I think as we move towards a society that's even more dense, right, as we progress, the density part of it also helps, because you don't really need to travel as far and you have all the amenities. So this is the part where we have, in a way, started quite early through our land use planning to ensure that we plan for self-sufficient towns. And within these towns, within the transport nodes, we try to build for hire, cater for higher development, so that people do not walk or do not need to walk as far to go to schools, to pick up your groceries, and so forth. So it is really putting in the real infrastructure now, and I think this is where we have heard from Camilia. It is not just putting in the infrastructure, it's really trying to make it convenient and making it attractive and making it seamless. And if people don't feel safe using this infrastructure, they will probably just hop onto the car. So these are things that, as designers, as implementers, we need to take into consideration. The other aspect is what Kenneth mentioned about education and promotion. I think today, everything said, you can already see it in the newspapers that there is still a fair bit of conflict between pedestrians and cyclists. So this is where there should be some code of conduct put in place. There should be some understanding between the different users of the same space, so that we can live in greater harmony, rather than to think of as this is my space and, you know, please don't intrude into my space and so forth. So as we try to place cycling tracks off roads, so then it will be sharing with the pedestrians. So off and on, you'll see cyclists coming onto pedestrians and pedestrians going onto cyclists. So these are things that we need to look after in our design.
Can I just add one other thing, just in terms of urban form, which I think may be interest to people, and Ken, I think you can add to this as well. Is one of the things we did look at with the master plan in terms of the Marina Bay Southern Waterfront was, with density, when we get more and more buildings that are taller and taller, there's a lot of wind that comes down from the buildings. So as everyone here is getting a little bit warmer, as the heat kind of happens in the room, you get the fans, and the wind is blowing on you, which helps to cool you. So one of the macro things that we started looking at was actually how to use building form through code to actually, and guidelines, to have that building form bring wind down to the street level, to create the wind on the street level, which is a new idea in terms of the urban design and urban form of the city. And with density, you have that ability to do that.
Actually, personally, I do cycle to work about twice a week. And, you know, when you come out early in the morning, there's actually, you know, with this wind blowing on you when you cycle, due to the speed that you cycle, you actually don't feel, you know, terribly sweaty when you reach the office. And when you go home in the evening, it's cool again. So actually, personally, I find that, you know, at the times of days that I use the bicycle as a commute, it is actually quite comfortable. And, you know, it helps also that, you know, the city is quite compact and that the distances are actually quite short. If you do intra-town or even for me, when I cycle from where I live to where I work, it's under 10 kilometers, so it's quite doable. Kenneth, you wanted to add something?
Yeah. I just wanted to make a comment about the weather, and sorry that I messed up your script. I think we live in a tropical country, and I think as a nation, we have grown up getting so used to being in comfortable air-conditioned environment. I remember being in, you know, in the younger days, going to school in a non-air-conditioned bus. And of course, things changed, better quality of life these days. But remember, we live in a tropical country, so you need to be prepared to perspire at some point in time. It's part of your journey. And I say that, and that's my personal comment. And really, there was this, somebody gave this quote and said, there's no such thing as bad weather or wrong weather, it's just wrong clothes. So it's a matter of, are you dressed appropriately? Are you in the right spot? You know, shade is being provided, and parks. LTA is providing quite a bit of sheltered walkways, although there has some compromises with greenery and shade as well. But we are living in a tropical country, and perhaps I think we are also trying to move active mobility in a way that I'm not sure. I've Googled it and I checked whether any other tropical country have tried to roll a national cycling plan. I think not yet. We are probably one of those starting out, and I see there's a lot of opportunities for us to move in this area, because we really have spent quite a few decades moving people in different forms, by car, by buses, by trains, and this is really one of those things that we feel will provide that first mile, last mile connectivity and really help us in promoting the use of public transport, which will remain the backbone of our transport system.
Actually, Camilla, you have worked in very hot climates to provide cycling infrastructure and design. What is your comment about the weather?
Well, we've done some work both in Zambia, in Africa, and in Muscat, and in Mexico City. And I think all of them are not as humid as Singapore, and that's one of the big differences. So in the hot climate, besides the wind and the shading we're hearing, it's also about the distance you travel. And so obviously here it's maybe looking at the last mile, the last kilometer, because we would be rather reluctant to cycle at great distances. But I think Singapore is in this fantastic situation where you have a very compact city. It's relatively flat also, which is a good idea for bicycling. So this is one of the cities or countries in the world where it is actually very, very possible to have cycling, even though it's a tropical climate. But it's a question of a mind shift also. I mean, is it seen as something that is only for the hipster or for the bicycling fanatic on Sundays, or for the very poor? Or is it seen as something that everyone can do at all times? And particularly when I see the few people that cycle in Singapore today, I see very few women.
You haven't seen me.
I haven't seen you. You go so fast, Limin. I can't even see you. I'm not sure. Maybe you can answer that better than I can. If there's something culturally here that could be interesting to work with, because I don't see very many women cycling.
Actually, I do see a lot of women cycling, especially in the new towns, who are going to the market or sending their children to school. So maybe you haven't been hanging out in the right places. Yeah. I mean, because I think cycling in Singapore is particular in the sense that it is not just the lycra-clad people like Scott, you know, who might be, you know, cycling to work, you know, on his racer bike, but it is for, you know, housewives who run errands and kids to school, for old men, if you go around Chinatown, there are many old men on bicycles because they find this most convenient and affordable. And I think many of our foreign workers also find that it's one of the most convenient and affordable ways to get around Singapore. I think that might be a good segue for Cliff to share on some of our current efforts in Singapore on creating good cycling infrastructure and planning, as well as walking initiatives.
Hi, okay, I thought I'd just share with you our national cycling plan. This is something that we work with the inter-agencies for a couple of years now. Basically, the national cycling plan is to facilitate cycling as a safe and convenient option. So this is that emphasis that I just mentioned earlier. If it's not safe, it's not convenient, then you know it's not as easy to get people to use this infrastructure. And like what we mentioned earlier, the climate that we have, so short commutes, short distance commute is very attractive. But how can we then move forward as well to ensure or at least encourage people to cycle a little bit further than just short commutes? The other aspect about this cycling plan is that we want to develop a very comprehensive cycling network, and we will want to start off with a off-road cycling. So we are looking towards building up 700 kilometers island-wide, hopefully by 2030. And this is very much a multi-agency effort. So you can see many of the government agencies are here, right, including Land Transport Authority, who are taking care of the intra-town cycling, our NParks, who are looking at the park connectors, HDB, Sports SG, PUB, because at times we need to work with them to cover up our drains to gain that space, as well as JTC, HPB, and traffic police, and not to mention also cyclists and enthusiasts. So this is something also a little bit different in our cycling plan, where we have roped in two cyclists, activists. One of them is here, Mr. Francis Chu, who has been very supportive of the plan. But we do bounce off ideas with people like Francis to get feedback and to see what works and what doesn't work as well. So the vision for this cycling plan is really for a cyclist-friendly, well-connected network, providing safe and healthy cycling for all. And the key strategy is really to develop this comprehensive and well-connected path. We are also looking at enhancing the cycling supporting facilities. So this is that end of trip. You have the origin, but you don't have the destination, or sometimes you don't even have the origin to park all these facilities. And of course, to develop this cycling culture amongst all of us through programs and education. So you can see from where we are starting off as a base, we are not starting off from a clean slate, right? Today, our park connectors are quite evident throughout the island. We have something like 200 over kilometers. LTA is also progressively moving into all these intra-town cycling networks to try to build up within cycling within towns the cycling network. But what we find that is lacking in this plan is how do we then connect all these other towns together, as well as to bring people into the city center. So this is where we have worked over the last 1.5 years to identify where all this intertown routes that we think are also just as important to add that final jigsaw puzzle. And of course, we have this round island route, which is 150 kilometers around the entire island. Then with this network in totality, we think we will have a better chance to get more people to cycle. So apart from this infrastructure, we, as I mentioned, we are also looking into all these other cycling facilities. So bicycle racks is very important, not just at transport nodes, but also at developments, right? And even in our living environments as well. So HDB in this aspect in the past has been providing one rack for every 10 units. But going forward, HDB in their new areas, they are going to up this provision to one in every six units. Bicycle crossings is also a key factor in this network. While it's easy for us to just draw up the lines, it's really the crossings that sometimes deter people from using them. So how we cross over expressways or under drains and so forth, it's something that we really need to look at in greater detail. So we are really working towards this as an interagency effort. Signages. I think many of us today, we also do realize that yes, there are plenty of signs, but we also do see signs that perhaps are a little bit contradicting each other, right? So within this interagency work group, this is where we are also working together amongst the different agencies to try to harmonize all these different signs so that we have one singular signage that is comprehensive to everybody, all right? So whether you're a pedestrian, whether you're a cyclist, whether you're a car user, you can understand it. And of course, the consistency in the design. As I just mentioned in the past, NParks has been building their park connectors and LTA has been building their intra-town network. And of course, in some of the heartlands, you also get the town councils implementing their own cycling routes as well. So this is where we try to put all the different parties together to see, can we get a more coherent and more consistent design on the ground? But apart from all this hardware, this is that software aspect that we are also trying to concentrate on. And the code of conduct will be very useful if once it's drawn up, right, to hopefully get everybody to better understand each other's needs. And within a very dense environment like ours, really you need to better understand and hopefully be able to be more gracious to people, other users of the same space. All right. Just to share with you, today, many of our roads, we do have sidewalks, all right, but it's very limited. In totality, it's only 6.5 meters wide. And within the 6.5 meters wide, we are looking at trying to put in the service verge, which is 3 meters, another 2 meters for our planting for our trees, and then followed by a 1.5 meter walkway, of which we have the PUB drains underneath it. So it's already very compact. So now that if we are trying to put in an infrastructure of cycling paths, of sheltered laneways, of crossings, all right, pedestrian crossings coming down, of BFA ramps, right, all these landing areas coming down within road reserves, these are all large infrastructure, and we need to accommodate it within our landscape. The other area that we have started, this is a little bit newer to us because we haven't moved as far as we have in cycling. But on walkability, it is also another very key aspect of how we can tie up this first and last mile. So why is it important? Because I think we are all aware we are moving towards a rapidly aging population, okay? And of course, with higher density now, this is where we really need to take a look at what is it that we have been providing in the past and whether it's adequate in future, okay? And as we move towards this green mobility, public transport is gonna be the key backbone of it, right? So walking and cycling, we need to also see how can it tie in better so that it is one integrated and one ecosystem rather than being separate entities. And hopefully with that, we are able to also then encourage people to leave their cars at home more often and think about more healthy living. So we have also drawn up the vision for the good walkability, right? So it is something that we want, a convenient, safe, comfortable, and something that's delightful as well. So this is that softer part of it that, you know, got our brains cracking to try to see what is it that we can encourage people to walk more. Okay, it is again another interagency effort, right? But essentially with the same agencies. So in this particular work group, what we will try to do is develop a set of strategies and plans to enhance walkability, and not just for the mobile, but for those less abled people as well, and for all ages across. And we will want to take a look at the what we have been providing in the past, right? The provision standards, the design standards, the signages, and so forth. And we will want to also look into not just public housing, but also private housing areas to see how can we facilitate walking amongst our people. Okay, so walking as we know it, right? I mean, today if you were to walk onto any roads, the pavement is already there, right? But how walkable is it? How convenient? How safe is it? This is something that we haven't quite looked into. So we feel that there's a need to do some auditing, right, in our public and private housing areas. So this will bring up all the different needs and requirements as to how we can further improve on our walking infrastructure. For instance, we do see a pavement there, but if it's, you know, potholes, if there are potholes, and if the uneven surfaces, so these are areas that we want to pick up. If it's something that's connected and then it abruptly stops into a set of staircase, so how can you expect someone with a pram, right, a mother, how is she gonna get down the stairs? So these are the small little things that we are trying to pick up in this exercise. And just to close off, and lastly, it's I think this was featured in the Straits Times after Minister Kaur Boonhwan made a mention that cycling should be a viable transport option for short trips around Singapore. And I hope that it won't be to the stage where we face congestion, car congestion all over the place before we think about cycling. Thank you.
Thanks, Keith. Okay, one of the topics that we actually discussed in the book that you have is really what are the roadblocks that we have to overcome in order to implement active mobility. I'll ask the panel first for a one-word answer to this, and I'll follow up with a follow-up question. So, roadblock. Camilla.
Courage to prioritize.
Okay, courage. Okay.
Cooperation.
Okay, cooperation.
I think we need the necessary investment as well.
Actually, these are not cooperation. You mean the difficulty in getting cooperation, right?
For example, PUB, yes, yeah, with the drainage,
okay,
and then the
interagency
LTA with the road right away.
Okay.
And then NParks coming on top of that.
Okay. Okay.
Which we saw, which is in the book actually. that challenge is in there.
Okay. And so, Cliff, you said.
I think about. Investment, I mentioned investment,
yes, okay,
but investment is also about our resources, whether we can make the available space for all this infrastructure.
Okay, that's too many words, yes. Okay, and yes, one word.
I think it's still space.
Space.
Ultimately, still space.
Okay,
yeah.
I'm going to ask you all to elaborate on how we can overcome these obstacles. So I'll start with you, Ken. Space.
So the challenge about space is trying to prioritize. I think Camilia talked about prioritizing the use of for different groups of users. Here we have cyclists, we have people who walk, pedestrians. Obviously, we have people who use the roads. It's not just the motorists. You have commuters on the bus. So it's really, and also we have greenery, and something that we hold dear and treasure. So I think for us, it's really that constraint of space. Cliff talked about 6.5 meters, that's what we have today. And
that's because you didn't take any space away from the road.
Well, I mentioned motorists as one group. As I said, the road space is also used for other purposes. It's not just for motorists. The bus commuters, 80 of them who are traveling on that 3 meter wide lane needs that space as well. So clearly, which is why I picked the word spaced. But that said, at some point, we will probably have to think a bit harder. Who gets more priority of use of space? Is it about efficiency? Is it about moving enough people, given the amount of space that we have? Or is it about some other ideas, more livable?
It shouldn't be about the speed of cars.
Well, speed of cars is still about moving people. It's about moving people optimally.
Do you know that if there are very few cars on the road, I can drive at 100 kilometers per hour? I'm actually very efficiently using the road, but actually the road
disagree.
Is not efficient.
I would disagree. It's not about how fast you travel. Here we are really talking about how many people can we move, which is why the mass transit, mass public transport is still the most efficient. We could move a fully packed train can take 1,800 people. Moving at fairly high speeds, so it's about optimizing the use of space and ultimately trying to strike a balance between the different groups of users. Bearing in mind that here we're also talking about users moving at different speeds. Pedestrians move at a certain speed, 4 kilometers per hour and slower. Elderly probably move even slower than that, and we have a whole range, and they're of different sizes. So the issue with speed, velocity, and also the issue with mass. So, I mean, not trying to be too scientific
about it.
Sounds
very physics to me.
Yeah. But here, we're just trying to balance that use of space between different groups of people.
So maybe, Cliff, investments, money.
Well, investment is in... it's also about space and living in a dense environment. How much is it that we can attribute to walking and cycling? Investment is also something I thought we should have greater awareness of. I think if you look into the past, we have been implementing a lot of road infrastructure and heavy investment has been put in to it. But in comparison, walking and cycling, maybe we haven't done as much. So this is something that I thought, going forward, we should reassess what is it that we really want, and if it's something that is worth investing, it should be. But I do sympathize with Kenneth about the space, because yes, we, as an interagency discussions, we face it almost every time we meet up, you know, because like I mentioned, within 6.5 meters, you want to squeeze in a 2 meter cycling track, something has to go, something has to be compromised. So do we want less greenery? Do we want less road space or whatever? But as I mentioned, if you have seen in the papers, the voice of cyclists may not be as loud, because you also do hear a lot of comments about other users that they find that why should the government be investing so much on cycling infrastructure? Why are we doing all these things? So there is also this segment of the population who do understand or have a different views, right? They have a different understanding and different views about cycling and walking. So this is something that we need to see how we can go about it, because this first and last mile to public transport is very important for us, and I think we need to work together as a society.
Cooperation.
Can I change my...
No. Yes, go on.
No, I think it's really interesting, because the way in which urban mobility is one of the most important things in terms of city planning and how we move around our cities. And it takes a cooperative position by everybody in order to make that as easy and convenient for as many different users as possible. And so that cooperation, I think, I moved to Singapore in 2007, and I've seen a dramatic change in the way in which the agencies have worked together on land use issues, cooperative land use issues, dealing with the verticality of that land use. I mean, your horizontal plane in Singapore is pretty prescribed in terms of who gets what, but that vertical plane has the ability to actually be challenged a bit in terms of how you can create multi-mode within a vertical, either underground at grade or above ground. Now, the implementation of that can be done through private and public ventures, of which you have real estate helping to fill in some of that, private real estate helping to fill in some of that void through the urban design guideline process, which is very unique to a lot of cities, where you have that ability to create those partnerships. And then also within the agencies themselves, and I think this is something where even the Land Transport Authority in the last year, they have upgraded their vision. If you take a look at the wording in the vision, actually has people in it now. And it doesn't have just cars and trains and roads. The people is actually, and the publication or the video that they put out is about people. So I think that kind of dialogue where people come first, and your 8.5% for roads, your 7.5% for green space, your 12% for land development, those boundaries can be blurred a lot more. So I think there's a lot more work to go with that, but I think the agencies are doing a better job of it nowadays.
And Camilla, courage. Ah.
Yeah. I think it's been said excellently already that at some point we have to decide what we want to do, and we have to make those courageous decisions, because we cannot keep expanding at the rate we're going. There simply is not enough space or enough resources in our world. So obviously that takes courage to be the first to implement that. And I do think that this is a country and a city that has previously shown courage and shown that you can implement vast systems in a short amount of time. You have shown the strength to do that. So I think active mobility can be the next step. And I think a key to this is that it's also about personal mobility and about the freedom of choice. So I don't think anyone on this panel is saying that we should ban cars altogether. I know that Jan-Gil does have a vision that Singapore will be the first city in the world that has no cars in 2050, but I won't mention that. So does the EU, by the way. Central European cities by 2050 are going to be carbon free. So see if you can beat us to that. But I really think that there's a lot of opportunity now also with the increased technology we have available to increase personal mobility in our cities. Things like car sharing, different apps that actually allow a transport system not to be systemized, but actually to be very individual, are available. So I think we need to see active mobility and bicycling not as an individual point, but as part of the entire system.
Well, I think I hear from you in the sense that one side of the stage is talking about mindset change, and another side of the stage might actually be talking about the need to put in the correct and proper infrastructure. What is the view of the panel? Which one has to come first, mindset change or infrastructural change?
Well, I won't try and prioritize them, but really infrastructure has to come in first to some extent in order to encourage people that, well, at least if you have some dedicated paths, if it is off-road, it's safe. So I think that aspect has to come in, and that's where I think there's quite a bit of effort that's been put in. And along the way, I mentioned earlier, we need to educate, maybe to a little bit of enforcement. So these three things really need to come together.
How about the rest of the family? Any views, mindset change or infrastructure change?
I'd say primarily infrastructure, just ease of use, to make it easy. If it's not easy, people won't do it. So I think that's fundamental.
I think if you're looking at Singapore's context today, infrastructure probably needs to be put in place before we can even talk about safety, convenience, and so forth to encourage people to cycle.
Do you agree?
Yes. Safety first. But I think I'd like to mention something. You mentioned in your presentation this idea of the aging population. And particularly for our aging group, safety is of a great concern for them to go onto the streets. So if we're going to have active mobility even into a ripe age, then we need to have the good amenities. And I think I'd just like to advocate this fantastic program that NGO has started in Copenhagen, where they use rickshaws and volunteer staff takes senior citizens in the rickshaw and cycle them around the city to visit their old school or the bench where they had their first kiss or where they had their first apartment. And it's really, really a nice program where the senior citizens get fresh air, they get to reminisce about their past, and the young and the old have a really nice social bonding about that. So I think there's a lot of ways that we can actually have these social programs integrated into our network, but the safety needs there to be there in order for us to put our senior citizens on the street.
Okay, I think that might be a good segue for me to sort of invite Scott to talk about some steps that other cities in the region have been looking to start active mobility initiatives. So Scott, please tell us about KL, where you have been spending a lot of time.
Thank you. Yeah, I've been spending quite a bit of time the last 2 years in Kuala Lumpur. How many people here have been to Kuala Lumpur? Raise a hand. How many people have not? Oh, actually, a few. Oh, you haven't? Well, then definitely at the end of the week, we'll have to get you to KL. So KL to a lot of people is this. In terms of 2 years ago, it was 93% private automobiles was the mode share. So it's very different in terms of the history and the development pattern of Kuala Lumpur, which has been really driven from the automobile and private sector coming in to fill development patterns around the Klang Valley, which has led to a lot of issues now in terms of that population has increased. It was fine when the city and the surrounding area was 2.5-3 million people, but now that it's 6.6 million people, it's becoming more an issue. And Kuala Lumpur has an overall goal to move to 10 million people. So there's no more capacity essentially for transportation from private automobiles. So a few years ago, the government went through a transformation program of which the land public transportation system came up with some goals around how they want to deal with mode share mix and how they want to prioritize around public transit, essentially to move to 40%. So this is very far from Singapore in terms of Singapore with the amount of people that use public transit here. But in Kuala Lumpur, the goal is to get to 40% by 2030. Currently, it's around 19%. So they've made a lot of progress in the last 2 or 3 years around five key strategic objectives, which have to do with being well-connected, having it affordable so people can actually use it, have it very convenient, again, that idea of ease of use, having it safe and secure, both safety getting to the place of which you get on, and then as well using the facilities, and then overall better quality of urban life. And around that was 14 key policies that were really around initially bus, taxi, and rail. Actually, urban rail is very light there, but the urban rail is the other part of that box. So that's really the starting point around public transportation as the starting point in terms of how you get people to it, how you get people to use it, and how they can start to decrease the amount of private automobile use. From a pedestrian experience in cycling, it's not perceived to be very pedestrian friendly. Sidewalks are not connected. There's a lot of start and stops, and then there's a lot of people who do not obey kind of general safety practices in terms of being on the sidewalk with motorcycles and those kind of things, in terms of just use of that right of way. It has been catching on a lot more recently, and I'll go through a couple of the reasons for that. But part of that idea in terms of the switch is in the denser parts of the city, that there's been a push in terms of trying to create some dedicated areas for cycling as well as for pedestrianization. And a lot of that, which was interestingly enough about the overall integrated urban transportation system and that last kilometer. The last kilometer has really pushed a discussion about walkability and cycling within Kuala Lumpur and the Klang Valley. So what was originally about moving people on public transit systems, about putting in a lot of rail, mass transit, to move a lot of people in a short time period, has then started to evolve into a discussion about that last kilometer, both getting there to the initial point of origin and then the destination and getting to the end area. So from that, there's been a lot of dialogue recently on then how to improve those networks and improve the different areas. A big part of that was just raising awareness that in a hot tropical climate, it was the same kind of arguments. Oh, I'm going to get sweaty. I can't walk more than 100 meters without getting in my car, which is air conditioned, to drive somewhere, and I need to park right outside. So a lot of the things that the mayor of Kuala Lumpur has been doing is around raising awareness with the local constituents. And one of the things that has been very successful is the idea of car-free KL. So what he's done is he starts with one Sunday, the first Sunday of the month, and they close the roads downtown. So this is the center part of Kuala Lumpur, and you can see the DBKL is on the bottom where the start component is, and then over on the far right is the Twin Towers, KLCC. And this area, what they do is they close the roads for about 4 hours, and they allow any type of transportation that's non-motorized to come down. So you can walk, you can run, you can skateboard, you can rollerblade, you can do any kind of thing that you want, as long as it's non-motorized, on the streets. And so this is in front of KLCC, and you can see rollerbladers, cycling, all kinds of activities. And it's become very, very popular in terms of when this started, the road was fairly empty. Nowadays, you have a hard time actually negotiating the overall route just because of the number of people. There's been festivals now that have generated around this, and because of the success, the mayor is going to be going to 2 Sundays of the month. So the streets are completely closed, no traffic is allowed. And I think when there's a few other cities that have seen this, the question always comes up, well, how do you pay for it? How do you pay for traffic enforcement, the police officers, all those other things that go along with doing this kind of large event? Like in Singapore, if you have a marathon, for example, roads closed for 3-4 hours, there's a cost to doing that. And often it's a fairly large cost. Well, one of the great things that DBKL did was they took their law enforcement officers who were on duty that day anyways, and they just redeployed them. So they actually put them on street corners. So there was no additional cost in labor to put this on, but it was a matter of changing the duty and priority for that day and for that morning. Plus, it also got more security officers that were out in central KL for the day. This is now expanded into looking at other cycling routes around central KL and how to then bring those routes into the city center. And again, a lot of this is about leadership. In the photo there, Dato Bandar is the person on the right, the mayor of Kuala Lumpur, and he's involved in a lot of this in terms of the plans moving forward. Now, the other part in terms of active mobility is the pedestrianization and network. And so similarly, downtown Kuala Lumpur has done a lot of work on how to make it easier to walk around. Some of this is at elevated crossings, like the image on the left, and some of it's actually the street itself to close some of the lanes of roads to increase the amount of sidewalk, and then also provide barriers between roadways and the pedestrian areas. A big component of this is a project called River of Life, which is the planning for the whole central district. And a lot of this is focused on the Klang and Gombak River, which runs through the center part of that image. It's about 10.7 kilometers in total length. And with that is about how to use some of the waterways which are right now primarily for flood mitigation, and turn those into transportation systems to allow for pedestrian cycling through the center part of KL without actually crossing road barriers. So you end up with boardwalks such as this, where you can have shared mode along it. You end up with a transformation of that urban area, which is very similar to the Singapore River, into this type of environment where you can cycle along the boardwalk. So this is under construction right now. There's a lot of closing of roads to create environments such as this, which again allows for pedestrian and cycling along the riverfront, which connects all of the major developments in central KL. And a lot of this deals with the streets, about how you get people down to the river. So there's a whole program in terms of upgrade of the street. So this is a before and after image in terms of allowing for more of that right-of-way to be turned over to the pedestrian, and taking some of the car and the car traffic out from the central areas of town. And this was actually me in Copenhagen a week and a half ago, experiencing the Copenhagen system and seeing how that could now integrate into the KL system, especially around traffic management. Thank you.
Thanks, Colin. Okay, we see that cities like KL is trying to give greater priority to pedestrians and cyclists' needs. I'm actually wondering, Camilla, from your experience in Copenhagen, does collecting a lot of data, as in Copenhagen's practice of counting pedestrians and cyclists, or what you call the city accounts, does this help with the planning process in a way? Because Kenneth was talking about, you know, balancing the needs of the various groups. So does this help having a lot of data-driven planning process?
In Copenhagen, we, and in an increasing number of cities across the world, I must say, we count the number of people walking and spending time in the city, and the bicycles in the city, just as we also monitor the traffic and the trains and the buses. And I think that is a really important factor in keeping the balance and actually assessing whether the goals, the strategies, and the money, you mentioned investments before, that are being put into to the system work. So for instance, I showed this red bicycle bridge at the start of my presentation, and there had been done a computer simulation before that was put in to estimate that 8,000 people would use it every day. It turned out that after it opened, 14,000 people were using it every day, because that was counted. So it was more than twice as popular than the computer had estimated. And that really has now given the politicians in the city the reason to say, we're going to build three more of these bridges in different places linking neighborhoods. So the data is proving to be very, very powerful in documenting how the money is being spent, how people are reacting, and fine-tuning the system. Seeing what should be done, should you maybe add more lanes in one place or subtract because people are using it in another way. For instance, we also monitor age and gender on the streets, so where can we see patterns in where women are cycling, where the young, where the old are cycling, and then use that as active guidelines.
Okay, that sounds very interesting. Which brings me to the next question, like essentially what are the roles that various sectors can play to help with building a culture of active mobility? Maybe, you know, looking at your backgrounds, Scott could share with us on how the private sector and developers could help. And Camilla, you can tell us in terms of, you know, urban design and the role of research, how that has helped in establishing quick wins for cities. And Cliff can perhaps tell us about the planner's perspective, and Kenneth can tell us about the incentives and the legislative kind of role that government agencies has been playing. So again, the role of different sectors in how we can establish this culture.
Yeah, okay. Yeah. I think, as I mentioned in Copenhagen, a lot of the data was very scientifically collected over many, many years. But it wasn't, high tech. It was just people looking at people on the streets. Today, a lot of it is automated through either GPS tracking or various sensors. But knowing that really qualified the work. But I think the interesting thing is also when you have different departments, different sectors working together. Another program I'd like to mention is a program in Copenhagen where the police force work together with the immigration services and with the job employment services to teach women, immigrant women, to bicycle as part of job training. So they become independent, they can go and they can apply for a job. So I think it's very difficult just to kind of signal in one sector that in order for something like this to be successful, it's important that there's a buy-in from both the hardware and the software sectors in a city.
I guess from the private sector, I'll approach this in two ways. One is as a consultancy group with AECOM, because we work in hundreds of thousands of cities around the world, and in some of the major cities that we're working in, a lot of the issues are similar in terms of how the city will grow and transform over time. And in cities that are less developed, that's a little bit easier in terms of how we work with the overall planning framework to create communities that are very well connected and connected through multiple modes of transportation. And some of these are very low dense communities, especially in the United States, where you don't have the population to support some of the mass transit options that some of the more dense Asian cities have. And so with that is that, again, the ability to easily connect from one area to the next and to connect in meaningful ways so that if you are in a lower density area, that you can connect to those things that you really need in terms of a center of employment, a center of commercial goods, the grocery store, that kind of thing that makes sense within a shorter distance, and being able to plan that in appropriate ways. In the more denser urban areas, then it's a matter more in terms of how to move the mass amount of people so you don't deal with congestion. That might be pedestrian congestion, might be bicycling congestion, it might be automobile congestion, but how do you do that in a way that can appropriate move the number of people that you need to do in the urban environments? So that's a lot of the work that I think we're doing with many different cities around the world, and it varies a lot depending on how developed the city is in terms of the sophistication of the program, the ability to survey, the ability to get big data back to actually make decisions. Some countries just don't have that yet. But at the end of the day, it's really about making it easy and convenient for people to move around. Now, on the private sector side, in terms of land development and real estate, real estate wants to try to often maximize the returns, the profitability of their projects. In order to do that, you want to create a place that people are happy in. Whether or not they're happy there to work, or they're happy to live, or they're happy to come there as a destination. And so if you're able to make it, again, easy and convenient to come to your place or to leave your place, then that is often, it can have a lot more success. And the other thing that we're starting to see is a lot of these green and blue type of connections are starting to be marketed as the main thrust behind the development. So you have developers actually latching on. For example, the River of Life project, almost every major developer that's doing a development along the river now brands it as River of Life. They brand it as walkable, convenient, and safe in the center heart of Malaysia. And it's that kind of thing that really grabs hold in terms of making it a very nice community.
The role of planners, I think definitely we do like to work with the with the local community, right? So for instance, the Club Street and the Haji Lane that closures, we did work with them, but as much as possible, we do want them to take ownership so that and support of it, so that it's really from the grounds up rather than a top down, because in order for such car-free initiatives to be successful, really we need the support of the local community to make it happen so that it's more sustainable. so that it actually can perpetuate, and then we'll get everybody to see the benefits that come from it, because the stakeholders themselves, the feedback that we get from them is that they do like it as well. Not only has it increased the footfall, it has also, the businesses have also improved, and they have also fed back that the customers do feel that it is much safer to walk in those areas, you know, after those road closures. So even some of the stakeholders have asked for to see whether can we consider even extending the hours of closure for some of these roads, and maybe even do it into a, you know, maybe even a more permanent thing. So these are things that we need to look at and assess.
Okay, Limin, your question was about legislation and incentives.
Well, you can, you know, that I thought would be a good question to ask you, but you can you can look at different roles, even like from the people sector and so on.
Yeah, I suppose car-free on car-free days, I think we're trying that out in Orchard Road. I think has been quite successful. Though there may be a bit more traffic built up in other places, I think generally has been the situation has been quite well managed. Well, whether we can get more stakeholders on board to accept some of these, and clearly they need to see something for themselves that. In other cities, I think KL, I think you also have generated a lot more interest. In some places, I am aware that because of more footfall, as Scott mentioned, I think it creates more businesses. I just want to touch a little bit on, since you mentioned legislation incentives. On the legislation part, obviously, in terms of cycling, active mobility, there's a whole series of things about regulating behavior. That's one part of it. But separately, I mean, to look at ways to encourage building owners to provide facilities which support cycling, such as bicycle racks. I think that's something they're working with URA, and we think that we want to encourage cycling. Clearly, it has to be end-to-end. You have to look at it from end-to-end perspective. And I think maybe beyond even we could be looking at legislation, we could be looking at providing some incentives. I also want to touch a little bit about maybe parking at home. Ultimately, I mean, many of us live in HDB estates. How do we get our bicycles up the lifts and also get into, you know, your storeroom, and we need to find a place to store them. So I think there's also the design aspect that will come in, as well as ensuring that we look at it from the end to end perspective, take care of the convenience of it. Otherwise, it's going to be quite tough, I think. So I think this is one area that we need to look at.
Well, I guess this might be a good point for me to invite you to talk about how active mobility fit into the future plans of mobility in Singapore. Kenneth.
I would do this sitting down because being the shortest among the panelists, you won't see me behind the rostrum. Okay. Okay. First slide about National Cycling Plan. I think Cliff touched a bit about this earlier. And really cycling is really about providing an alternative mode of transport. And we really want to link up see this as more of a first mile, last mile initiative. I mentioned earlier about it being that public transport remains a backbone, and it is. And I think it has to be, because we need to move that number of people within a certain distance. But a lot of things can be done within the HDB housing estates, because every HDB town has an MRT station. And in some cases, they have more than one MRT stations. Tampines will have, I think, four eventually, with the Downtown Line coming in. So I think it is quite viable for us to consider the first mile, last mile connectivity to the station. We're certainly leveraging on the Park Connector network. Cliff touched on this, that we are not starting on this afresh. And certainly a lot of work has been done. More than 200 kilometers of Park Connector network has been built. And eventually, we hope to reach more than 700 kilometers. And I think the figure today is just over 200 odd kilometers. So we probably about triple the length of what it is. And the plan is really to reach every single town. There are 26 towns to get today. More towns are still being planned. And the newer towns will also have will also plan with cycling in mind. You notice the blue circles are the ones that which have been completed, and they were largely focused on towns which had a strong culture in cycling. Tampines, Sembawang, Pasir Ris. Marina Bay was also because it was a new area, there was an opportunity to build in the cycling tracks. And clearly, the circles in green are the ones that are upcoming, a number of them. And we're really trying this effort to proliferate the cycling in more and more towns. And eventually, by 2030, all the towns would have its own cycling network. And how do we do this? Essentially, it's a set of off-road cycling network. And I think we look at it off-road because we think having dedicated off-road tracks are safer. We are aware of cities doing this, both on-road and off-roads. I think in Copenhagen is also a bit like that. Although my visit to Rotterdam, they probably do more off-road than on-road. Number of amenities, it needs to link to a number of transport nodes and key amenities, and largely within a road reserve. Currently, we are looking at a path of about 2 meters dedicated path. And I must say, that's probably the minimum that we want to try and achieve. In other cities, it's probably more, 2.5 meters, and probably 2.5 meters in one single direction. In our case, we do have the space constraint. We're trying to look at 2 meters and probably a bit of a sharing. Sorry, not sharing, on bidirectional. And in cases where we need to share, we probably have to increase that to about 2.5 meters. And again, leverage on the park connector network, PCN, for connectivity. And what are key considerations? Safety has to be number one. And clearly, we are trying to segregate different users. And it is clearly not possible in every situation. In some cases, the pedestrians and the cyclists will have to come together side by side. The other challenge for us is obviously the greenery, retention of the greenery as well as streetscapes. And there are some traffic considerations depending on the local configuration. And we do need a lot of buy-in from communities and the landowners. Okay, in the area of education, this is quite a big area. And I would call this perhaps one where it requires a lot of coordination effort. Perhaps a many helping hands sort of approach where many agencies need to come together to ensure and promote safe cycling among different groups of cyclists, which is why you see it's the Road Safety Council come in, LTA of course, traffic police, MOE for schools, MOM, largely due to foreign workers, NParks because they're a group of leisure cyclists, and also Sport Singapore because of there's another group of sport cyclists. Many efforts have been done. I think this is still ongoing and many will still be organized. Just list down some of the efforts here very quickly. And publicity materials are one way that I think different agencies reach out. And I mentioned, as mentioned earlier, I think we do need an approach where we can try and reach as many diverse groups in a targeted manner as possible in terms of safe cycling. Besides that, we must have supporting facilities. We started off with MRT stations. In fact, for those who remember, there weren't many bicycle racks, say 5 years ago. We have really ramped up these numbers. Today, we probably have something in excess of 11,000 bicycle racks out there, and more will be built. You may also have heard we are building the Thompson Eastern Region Line, and we will also have underground bicycle racks and parking spaces. And in a way, it makes sense because after all, we are building the MRT station underground. We are digging. There will be space, and we want to devote some of this space to allow for parking as well. Bicycle crossing, I think Cliff touched on this earlier. I think this is also another important area where we dedicate the picture on the left and right shows before and after. Basically, trying to give a bit more space And in so doing, what it means is we just have to push back the stop line for motorists and create a bit more space for cyclists to cross in a safe manner. This is not unique to Singapore, clearly. A wheeling ramp is one way, well, we have built many overhead bridges over the years. One way for us to try and facilitate cycling is to put in some wheeling ramps, retrofit it, and so that at least bicycles can be pushed across. Obviously, ideally, they won't even have to do this if they have to cross at grade or on surface. But the fact that remains, we have many pedestrian overhead bridges. Instead of seeing them as obstacles, can we find ways to work around them and at least provide make some provisions? Bicycle sharing system done in a few cities, I think quite successful. So this is something we are also looking at. And we are really keen to try this out, perhaps in the Jurong Lake District. Also because we are, as part of the cycling plan I mentioned earlier, I think we will be completing out the cycling tracks in that area around about this time frame. So we thought it is appropriate to pilot this in the Jurong Lake District. Much about cycling, so a bit about walking. We have put out the walk to ride framework. And again, the key is to provide shelter. We talked earlier about the weather, greenery, and here we're looking at providing about 200 kilometers of sheltered connectivity by 2018. And again, it's about trying to promote the use of public transport. Again, first mile, last mile. And we have, in fact, the criteria has been reviewed to allow us to extend beyond the 400, and in some cases, another 200 to other transport nodes such as LRT, bus interchanges, and high patronage bus shelters. But this remains a challenge. Why? Because it takes up space. Some greenery will be affected. And we really want to try and find a way to work with NParks. NParks have many good suggestions. Can we green the roof? Can we have different ways of making the hard infrastructure a little bit softer? So I think those are the kind of measures or ways that we work as interagency. Cliff mentioned a bit about that earlier, and the cooperation as well. And along the way, we it's not just about providing roofs. I think it's important as we walk, rest areas are also provided. We talked about the elderly population. I think it's important. Of course, the next thing you ask is, will there be toilets? So we'll start off with the rest areas, and we have to work from there. Wayfinding, I think, is quite important. As much as we are familiar with our own neighborhood, when you get to the next town or a new location, many of us do rely on signage and locality maps to get around. I just want to touch a little bit on this about Travel Smart Network. Why? Because it's, for us, it's not just about promoting active mobility. This is only one part of the whole transport chain. I think for us, while as much as we're ramping up the efforts to increase the public transport capacity, that's on the supply side. We're also trying to find ways to mitigate on the demand side. In other words, trying to trying to encourage companies to spread out the peak. As much as we've heard about free public transport, if you travel before 7:45 in the morning in the city, it needs for companies to have a system that allows some flexibility. So we are trying to really work with companies, incentivize them to see if we can get them to arrange a more flexible working arrangement. LTA, for instance, we have a flexible working arrangement. Myself and staff, once a week, we could telecommute and no questions asked. So these are some of the things that we are really trying to do and in a way trying to take the lead as well. And I put this out also because part of that Travel Smart grant allow companies to install bicycle parking facilities and shower facilities, so that companies can come to us and make those claims and show us that they have indeed provided parking. And obviously it's not just about cycling, it's about getting them to come to work early. And what do you do with the time when you come to work early? If you can get them to exercise, have a morning breakfast, initiatives like that, I think we really welcome. Okay, I think that's all.
Okay, now that, thank you, Kenneth. Yes. Now that you've heard from all the panelists, I'm going to open the session to the floor. We'll take 3 questions at a time. Please introduce yourself and where you come from before you start. Yes, okay, Maria, yes. Yes, Maria first.
Maria Boy from the Institute of Singapore Institute of Planning as well as Institute of Parks and Recreation. I have just been to Copenhagen. In fact, I've been there 3 times. The first time I walked from the hotel, which is near the Little Mermaid, down to town, and I was so delighted because I could walk without any fear. The whole day I was just walking. But what I did is I stopped at different places to look at buildings. So that makes my journey very enjoyable. Recently I went again, and this time with a very clear vision of studying about cycling in Copenhagen, and also talking to the people, because what we have in Singapore, I think, I trust the government can do a lot of things, but one area that our panel do not touch on is the software about people, and that I concern about our generation of young. They have to be taught how to cycle, because that will prepare them for the future. And I believe that also cycling in the city has been very difficult for us. We did one exercise recently in March, and the ladies, you know, they cycle, but they cycle in different places. And the lady says it's very hazardous to cycle in the city. And it's true, because there are too much traffic lights. And so if we can close some roads, then we can improve our cycling in the city. And for a bit of publicity, both the Institute of Parks and Recreation and Planners, we are doing a cycling for heritage. And that's where we can also increase the hotels to even allow their tourists to cycle within the city, because a lot of European countries, they come in and they are looking at bicycles and how they can cycle. So I hope LTA will make the city more usable, especially on Sundays. Free
okay,
cycling
thank you,
days.
Maria. Yeah, okay, we'll take the next question from Professor Exhausen first. Yeah.
Thank you, Kai Exhausen, ETH Zurich. Two questions. Have you already adjusted your internal guidelines for road design as part of the National Cycling Plan? Because there's lots of little details which you can avoid building again and again if you do them, and you can do them now. And the second question is, you talked about sharing and dividing up the space, but it's also dividing up the time. And it's particularly noticeable that Singapore has one of the most unfriendly signal control systems for cyclists and pedestrians I've ever been. Are you considering putting in a maximum limit to the cycle time so that you don't have to wait for an hour and a half or two waiting for the next green man? Is that something which the LTA is also considering?
Yes, thank you. And John? Yes.
Oh, yeah. I have two observations, and I'd like the panelists to give me their gut reaction to it. And hopefully CLC will also take back some of the comments to rethink. First observation is, I hear a lot today about cycling city. There's some comment about walking city as well. We seem to miss a very important third ingredient of any good city, which ancient planner never got. People like Camilo City, a sitting city. Okay, that's the first observation. Our second observation is that, again, I think through all the workshop on the highly organized activities and even talks like today, everybody is enamored with cycling. But I keep hearing a lot of problems that cycling brings to city planning, to the use of the city, and so forth and so on. I think the center focus at the moment is cycling. There are two limbs on the two sides which I think are very good technological innovations which will solve a lot of problems. One is e-scooting, and the other one is i-roading. Okay, so I like comments from
John,
the panelists.
Can we come to your question, please?
Yeah. Comments from the panelists.
Okay.
I think e-scooting is a solution that actually addresses the climate directly, rather than making apologies about, oh, we can't change it and all. You can change a lot of the city planning. You can change some part of the culture of people over a long time. But e-scooter is an immediate solution that can save a lot of problems in Singapore right away. The other solution to address the COE and the usage of road, and that is iRoad. Thank you.
Thank you, John. I'll just take one question from Mr. Lau first, and then we'll put it to the panelists. Yeah.
Lu Ming, perhaps not so much of a question, but two comments quickly. So number one, I must say I'm very happy to know now that LTA is our friend. We always thought that we are fighting on the opposite end. I'm very happy that you are planning on the off-road cycling, which is much safer. And I also support LTA's suggestion to have a fine balance. This afternoon, you changed my mind about it. In the past, I always think that we should give maximum to cyclists. And now observation, I'm sorry, Camilia. I was also in Copenhagen together with Maria. I cycled for 2 days at the same time that she was walking. I must say I was also a bit overwhelmed with the amount of cyclists in Copenhagen. They were swamped. I feel it's too swamped with people. Number two, you have big problem to store your bicycle, which is an eyesore and a lot of collapsed bicycle everywhere. So therefore, a fine balance between cycling and public, and I support that. The big bulk of population go by a bus, and some who wants to cycle then will not at least clutter up our city the opposite way. So then question number, comments number two is perhaps LTA should look at an MRT, should look at a bicycle in MRT, not an absolute no, but look at the time bar. If it is peak hours, dedication for people, non-peak hour should allow bicycle to be.
It's allowed.
Oh, it's allowed. Okay, thank you.
Okay, thank you
very much.
Mr. Lau,
thank you. And then finally, is that since Singapore, we are already very bold in doing a lot of unpopular things like COE and very high tax. I don't see why we are not able to be very bold in our really a revamp of all the cycling, making it a cycling city. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Lau. So I will just take this four first, otherwise we will forget. Okay, so a brief summary, a question about what do we do about the future by educating our children about cycling, that's number one. Number two, about sharing of space and sharing of time in the sense that our traffic signals seem to favor cars. And then a question about what do we do about e-scooting? And number four, can we be very bold in our revamp of what we do for cycling and walking? So who wants to take which question? You are dying to go, so yes, Kenneth. Yes. Yes.
As expected. Maybe I'll take the question, the comment about cycling abilities. I think one thing that intrigued me, and I think it seems everybody in this room have been to Copenhagen, so I've been to Copenhagen myself, I've been to Copenhagen and Rotterdam, and I think it's in Rotterdam that the Dutch tells me that they have a cycling, they start them from young, and they are required to learn cycling, the practical cycling skills, and required to take an exam. So if you fail the exam, you don't get your whatever PSLE and all that. So I think that's interesting. And clearly, because the culture of cycling in Singapore hasn't quite been there. Some will argue that in the 60s, our forefathers used to cycle. Actually, not really that true. People that I speak to tells me that in the 50s and 60s, bicycles were actually quite expensive. In those days, the name they quote me was Riley. There's this very popular brand called Riley, built in England, but it cost about $100. So it wasn't really a very practical way to move around. So people were walking and people were taking buses. So cycling wasn't quite there wasn't really a strong culture. So I think going forward, if you're talking about cycling being one of the active mode of transport, I think we need to work with MOE and to find ways that we can teach our children. I think they have to start young. So that's one. The other comment about road design, we are undertaking some reviews. So clearly, we need to look at how best can we make it safe for cyclists. Again, it's about safety at junctions where most accidents tend to happen, and traffic junctions typically is not just cyclists; it's most dangerous for cars as well. Cars and pedestrian, cars and cars. So traffic junctions is one area that we have to undertake a review in terms of the design as well. e-scooters. I think today there's a whole range of what we call personal mobility devices, and we created another acronym called PMDs. It's not just e-scooters, there are segways, you have all sorts. I think clearly there needs to be clearer rules, what's allowed, what's not allowed. But it is something we have to grapple with. Like it or not, we are pretty close to China, and you know, all these very affordable ways of moving around is coming to Singapore, and we have to deal with it. So we have to undertake that review. In Copenhagen and in Rotterdam, hardly any. I don't see many e-scooters. I don't see many foldable bikes. They are your large, full-scale bikes, very hardy, also very expensive, I was told, 300-400 euros. But everybody used them. But our situation is quite different. We have a whole range of equipment, so to speak, riding on roads, riding on pathways. So we have to take a closer look at that. Have I covered all?
Okay, I think more or less. You did. Okay, I'm going to take the next round of questions, but on the condition that you keep your comments short, and hopefully it is a question. Okay, yes.
Very Raymond, quickly, yes. Raymond Kwok from Kwok Group LLP and Bike Towers. I have an interest to declare because I provide bike towers. Now, just a question. Can you all answer who is paying for all this? Because at the end of the day, bicycle, my understanding is that nobody is charging. Up to now, maybe Copenhagen you share with us, and you know what other city does, and how does we pay for this? I think it's very important. All this cost that is, you know, building around the infrastructure, or whether it's the usage, or whether you decide that a road should be prioritized for bicycle rather than cars.
Okay, next question. Yes. Ken. Yes.
Ken Hickson from Sustainability Showcase Asia. I just wonder if all members of the panel saw a very enlightening article in the Straits Times a few months ago from Kishore Mababani, where I think the headline was, Singapore needs fewer roads and fewer cars. And I do get the impression here that we're talking more about getting pedestrians to share the footpath space with the cycles than shutting off a car lane for cycles, which is what I think has happened in many parts of the world. So I think it could be a way of forcing cars off the road and forcing more people to do the healthier, more environmentally friendly and energy efficient thing to ride a bike or walk.
Good question. Yes. Francis.
Hello, I'm Francis from Love Cycling. I want to ask a question about, because previously there was a discussion about the space constraint, and it's very hard to find space to create a bicycle lane. And in front of my house, there's a road. Each lane, there's a two-way small street. Each lane is 4.5 meter wide, and it's like 1.5 meter more than the standard 3 meters wide. And I go around, mention in several neighborhood area, in Bedok, in Tampines, there are also many neighborhoods, small roads, they are quite wide in terms of space. Will LTA consider to experiment maybe in these small stretches of roads to start experimenting with bicycle lane, protected bicycle lane, I mean, to see how does it have an impact on existing car, because we are not reducing the number of car lanes, but just narrow it down to create the space for bicycle. So see whether it facilitates more cycling, at the same time, does it have a negative impact on existing car driving?
Okay, thank you, Francis. We'll take this bunch of three questions first. So who is paying? And then secondly, why should we be squeezing pedestrians off the sidewalk rather than squeezing cars so that, you know, we have more space for cycling and for walking? And thirdly, why don't we do a pilot project to test how well the protected bike lanes work? So who would like to take the question? Okay, Camilla. Yes.
So to the first question of who pays,
At least in Denmark, it's a combination between the municipality, so the city, and then some state or government-funded money that goes into the larger infrastructure projects that primarily connect the different cities or at a more regional level. Copenhagen did a study, which I think is quite interesting and worth mentioning, where they looked at the cost for society of bicycle lanes versus car lanes. And they were looking not only at construction, but also of the health benefits, of the loss of employment due to congestion, loss of earnings for businesses, all of these things. And they found that every time you build a kilometer of road space, as a society, we were losing 0.69 cents or øre in Danish. When we built a kilometer of bicycle lanes, we were winning 1 krona and 39 cents. So I think that's a way of beginning to understand that it's not just one box in a city. It's not just the LTA box. It's also the box that deals with public health. We have Mr. Liak here on the first row. There are a lot of other boxes that can actually benefit, and it is that very difficult piece of mathematics that has to go into some of these negotiations when we talk about who actually gains, because there are a lot more people that benefit and not just within the traffic department.
We try to do a lot on cost-benefit analysis in terms of the end user, whether or not that's private side that might have to pay for facilities or on the public side, and what that might mean and whether or not you want to make that decision to go forward in terms of alternatives. So we do a lot of testing and modeling around that. I mean, at the end of the day, public works department, the big ticket item is trains, rail. Mass transit is, especially in our context for Southeast Asia, there is a lot of capital cost going into that, and I mean that's something that can move a lot of people in a short period of time. So to try to get some of the budget allocation away from that into other modes is often difficult, even in the road sector. And if you look at road sector, a lot of the roads that are being built right now in Southeast Asia are concessionary PPP projects, of which you have private funding coming in to actually build those roads. They're not being funded by the public sector. Public sector is willing to back and put guarantees behind rail.
Space.
Of course, in Singapore, the infrastructure is paid for by the government, which comes from taxpayers' funding and so on. The question on carless, I think this is one key strategy. Well, I won't call it carless. In fact, one of the key strategies in our land transport master plan is reducing reliance on the use of private transport. So that's really one key piece. So maybe you've heard a lot about us trying to encourage and expand our rail public transport capacity, but really the other key piece is about reducing reliance on cars. And you would have heard the vehicle quota system. We have cut the growth rate. It wasn't long ago. In fact, we have been growing at 3% per annum. And in other words, we allow, besides the replacement amount, 3% growth since 1990 till around about 2008. We have since cut from 3% to what you've just heard, 0.25%, a quarter of a percent. Quota has come down, the supply has come down, and that translates into higher prices quite naturally. So that's one key piece that we will have to continue to work on. The other unpopular policy is obviously road pricing. That's managing usage. So that piece will also continue to be something that features quite prominently. You may have heard that the ERP technology is a little bit dated. It's discrete pricing at a particular point on the road, at a particular point in time. So we're looking at ERP 2. Hopefully that will give a bit more flexibility as well in terms of distance-based pricing and pricing for congestion. So these two pieces will be there. Regards to whether we can devote more space, I think the question was from cars to other users. I think
these effects have to take in, and we have to see how the performance on our roads is working. Clearly, we are still quite concerned about high levels of congestion. It affects the economy. Goods and trucks needs to move around. Public transport buses needs to move around. We have a lot of company buses. School buses need to move around. So we need to take care of that. I think maybe that is a good point to lead me to I think Mr. Francis' question. 4.5 meters. Probably you live in a landed estate with that wide. Okay, there are places that we have to look at in terms of how much road width we can allow. Maybe I'll just wind this back a little bit. Roads have been there for many years, since the colonial times, right? There have been standards in place and so on. But times move, so we need to be able to adapt to those. But one of the challenges we do face, clearly, well, maybe not in HDB estate, but in landed estate, is the width of the road. Rubbish trucks have a problem getting in. Emergency vehicles, some emergency vehicles can't get in, firefighting, so on. So we have to look at it and try and strike the balance. Whether HDB driveway can be narrower, perhaps, but you need to find a way to service the other amenities. So I think we need to make sure that there's still a solution. Maybe there's a smaller rubbish truck or something else. So I think if there's no need for such a wide space and there are ways, solutions around it, we will be happy to work with agencies to see how best we can work this out.
Okay, thank you, Kenneth. I think in the interest of time, I'm going to wrap up with one very quick question for the whole panel. This whole idea of Singapore as a cycling nation, what is your prediction? How many years will it take before we can be, you know, number one on the Copenhagenized Index, or at least we call ourselves a cycling nation? Camilla, how many years? 20, okay. 20. Scott? 2050 is, slightly longer, about 36 years. Okay. Okay, 2050 is the year to look for. Cliff?
As a planner, I'll be a bit more optimistic.
Like 2020? 2020, good! You see, we're hearing this from URA and LTA.
No, next. I mentioned a plan for 2030, so I'll gun for 2030, which is
okay,
long about the next 15 years. So infrastructure is there, and hopefully we can do more. And I think the other two pieces, education enforcement, need to come in as well. So
I'm very, very glad to see that our local agencies are more optimistic than our foreign experts. So with that, I think that's a good note to end this discussion panel. I'll hand the session back to Rian, our MC.
A very big thank you to all our panelists and moderators for sharing your insights and experiences with us. We would now like to invite Mr. Khoo Teng Chai, Executive Director of the Centre for Liveable Cities, to present our panellists with CLC in Your Eyes' latest publication. Mr. Khoo, please. Thank you, Mr. Khoo. Could I now invite our panelists and moderators off stage?